morning. Welcome to the big questions. I'm Nicky Campbell. 57% of single mothers of young children have never been married or lived with a man. From sink estate teenagers to middle-aged career women, raising a child without a father has never been so popular. Our first big question this morning, do children need fathers? Alex Borchardt, from Families Need Fathers. I think we know where you're coming from here. What is it specifically that is so important about the masculine role in bringing up a child?
I think both parents have a very important role to play in the child's life, and the mother and the father play very different parts in the upbringing. I think on the one hand, every child, every person has a real fascination for their identity, where they come from. And to deny a child the right of knowing who his or her father is, I think is very unfair. I think without wanting to stereotype, fathers might be good for sports, outdoor activities, and a lot of interests that perhaps the mother doesn't have.
What are the social consequences of so many children now not being in contact with their fathers and not having fathers when they're being brought up?
Well, on the one hand, there are, I think, close to 2 million single-parent families, mostly single mothers, and there are a great many children that grow up to have perfectly successful and happy lives who never have seen their father. But I think there are very widespread consequences when children are growing up without any kind of male role model. And it's very important for a child to have that balance of a mother and a father, or a father figure, perhaps a stepfather, if the father isn't around, in part of his upbringing.
Andrew Johnson, very much agreeing with that, I can see. Why is that?
Just to pick up on the point about role models, that's the key, really, isn't it? Children need love, they need stability, and they need good role models, both men and women, father and mother.
There are an awful lot of feckless fathers around, though, aren't there?
Yes, there are, but the fact of the matter is there are more good fathers than bad fathers, and it's important that men should have an input into rearing children, because there are men and women in society, and therefore it's important that the male input should be there just as much as the female input. We want our children to grow up to be balanced, well-rounded and mature, and men and women have a part to play in that.
Mrs. Campbell, this is the ideal, a mummy and a daddy, isn't it?
The ideal is that children should be loved and adored by the people who bring them into the world. They shouldn't be abandoned, they shouldn't be abused, they shouldn't be hurt. And that those adults and children live in a society that believes that this is a relationship worth having. Now, you know, when I was brought up, father spent, apparently, according to the statistics, around about 11 minutes a day with their children. Fathers in the most affluent and happy era of Walton-type family life in the 1950s, 11 minutes a day. Fathers were visitors to their families. There wasn't a debate going on then about, do children need fathers? Of course we did. But actually, we'd constructed a society in which fathers were expected to be providers, not parents. We now live in a society where the average father fathers better, children are better fathered than they've ever been, ever. They're probably better parented, they're better mothered than children have ever been on the planet, I should think. So what is this conversation really about? Should it be about, how about we change the length of the working week so that fathers are not in Britain working, especially when they're young, the longest hours in Europe and have the most starved relationships.
But when it comes to I appreciate this part. When it comes to psychological input and that balance that we've addressed, can two women be better than a man
and
a woman?
All research tells us that children brought up in households with lesbian parents are as well parented as children brought up in households where there's a man and a woman. So the debate really is about children being well parented.
Ray Barry.
Well, I would take issue with you beyond that. The data, the statistics, points to the best predictor of positive outcomes for children being brought up with married parents who live together. That doesn't deny the fact that some single parents, some lesbian couples might do a perfectly good, superb job of raising children. But I think this just disguises the fact that we've had a model of family since time immemorial, which in this generation, for no obvious reason, we're dismantling. And the
but
data...
It hasn't been since time immemorial. Actually, the shape of the family has changed dramatically, actually, with every generation and with all sorts of different political systems.
Are we dismantling?
You're assuming a family form of a man and a woman and 2.4 children that actually has been briefly a feature of 20th century Britain.
Well,
it's rather different in Sweden, and it was very different 100 years earlier.
I don't know where that data would come from, but my understanding is that we've had families ever since anybody can remember, which comprised a mother, a father, and children.
But isn't that the ideal? That, it may have been here briefly, but isn't that the ideal, Jonathan
Bartley? The ideal is that it takes a village to raise a child, not two parents.
The reality is the reality is prisons are full. Our prisons are full of fatherless children.
Our prisons are also full of men. And men are more likely to commit the crimes, they're more likely to abuse, and they're more likely to rape. But the point is, you know, the idea that's put forward that it's the married families that are happiest, it may be, but actually that's a self-fulfilling prophecy. The nuclear family is part of the problem, where we heap all this pressure on just two adults within a consuming society where they've got to work, they've got to bring up children, they've got to meet all these expectations, and most of them fall apart under all this pressure. What parents really need is a supportive community around them. You need as many fathers as possible, as many mothers as possible, bringing up those children in a communal context. And the emphasis on this narrow nuclear family is part of the problem, and it's actually going to lead to the family's disintegration rather than actually improving it.
Alex Borchardt.
Can I just pick on one thing there? It's well known that prisons were overcrowded. People are having to be let out early. There isn't room for people. 80% of the prison population come from broken families. That can't be a coincidence.
Well, and let me tell you this. 100,000 children a year now, as we speak, are the children of somebody in prison. We lock up twice as many people now as we did 10 years ago. We are producing a situation where this mass incarceration, 80,000 people, mostly young men, locked up, who have children, and many of those young men...
No male role model.
By role models, but they're useless role models, and they're the wrong role models.
They need to be good role models, don't they? And I think the point that Jonathan makes about the village is right. And in the village, there are men and there are women, and they each have a role to play in rearing the children.
So you chose, didn't you, to be a single mother, because it was better no father for your daughter Hannah than a bad one.
I chose to be a single parent. We were unhappy, and our unhappiness was having an effect on Hannah, and I decided it was better to raise her by myself than for her father to be around.
But there have been some quite interesting developmental studies done about the importance of that male role throughout life, in the early stage, in the slightly older stage, in the teenage years. Has she missed out on all that?
Of course she's missed out on somebody else being in her life, somebody she can refer to, this role model of her father. He has been in touch with her, she does speak with him on a regular basis. But in terms of the extra hug, the extra cuddle, she's missed out on that, and she's missed out on his perspective on life.
I think that's a very important point. Every family is different, every situation is different, and many children do thrive when they've just got that single parent. But a quarter of children in this country are growing up in two households. And I think looking at it from a child's perspective, I had a lovely morning yesterday with my son, and we went bowling, we played chess, and the subject of this program came up in the afternoon. And he said, "No, children don't need fathers." Thanks, Ted. but I would like to think that he's not being too serious there. And I think when any adult looks back on their childhood, they'll tend to be very glad that they did have both parents involved, or sad if fate played a cruel part in taking the father away if the father's died, for instance. Sometimes it can't be resolved.
But Kirsty, isn't this the case, as a clinical psychologist, is this not, as some would argue, this is what nature intended, a man and a woman to bringing up the child? Some would say this is what God intended.
It's not what I would say. I would say that parenting is about being consistent and predictable and offering nurturance. And it can be one mother, it could be two ladies, it could be two men, it could be the grandmother. That's the most important thing here. It has to be in the best interest of the child.